The hero at some point sees the dark side of his true hidden self, the side he's always denied for most of his life. This was that juncture for me. The Los Angeles Lakers, one of the most decorated franchises that the NBA has to offer, with a total of 16 championships to their name, winning seems to be an inherent part of their culture. However, it's not the only part of their culture, as the fame and notoriety that comes from playing with the City of Angels can quite easily turn even the purest of angels into demons, with the parties, the women, and the drugs all being ever-present, tempting you at every corner. It would take a man with the moral code of Jesus himself to be able to remain pure in the midst of temptation's sticky web. Or maybe, it would simply take no more than a man by the name of A.C. Green, whose story is just one of many stories that are to be discussed when it came to what some call the greatest decade in Lakers history. Welcome to part 2 of the shadow side of the Showtime Los Angeles Lakers. Shout out to SeatGeek for sponsoring this video. SeatGeek, the world's best way to purchase tickets to NBA games or any other live events, with a host of features, including being able to see a view from a seat before buying a ticket, a rating system for prices to make sure you're getting the best deal available, and also getting $20 off your first order by using the promo code SDC at checkout. The app really is a must-have for anyone who attends or plans to attend live events. Once again, thank you to SeatGeek for sponsoring this video, and I'll have the link so you can download the app down in the description box below. The average backcourt man gets about 300 rebounds a season. I'll bet Jerry comes up with at least 500. He's the tallest 6'3" player I ever saw. He can go right up there with the biggest of them to dunk in the ball. He's a tremendous passer, a deadly shooter from anywhere. Most of all, he has the timing, coordination, and sixth sense to be at the right place at the right time. To those who knew Jerry West for the quick, tough, high-flying, explosive guard that he was throughout the 60s and early 70s, that would be an accurate description of the player who would become the icon of the league itself. For those who knew Jerry on a more intimate level, however, the words oddball, lunatic, uptight, and more than anything, perfectionist would be the words used to describe the essence of West. He was such a perfectionist, he has always taken losses very difficult. Losses were harder on Jerry than winning was good for him. Winning was great, but losing was that much worse for Jerry. It was always very, very difficult for him. During his playing career with the Lakers, West was often so wound up and uptight that merely missing a single shot could put him in an agitated funk for the rest of the game. His need and desire to be perfect and do everything he could to help his team win on the court was so strong that West himself said that it would drive him to the depths of depression on a regular basis. His strive for perfection was in a way debilitating. That though mainly took place earlier on in his career. See, as he matured, he had learned to accept the fact that he could not be perfect through the help of women. I would lose myself in women. A lot of women, and I was married. I was bad. Jerry West. Former teammates, coaches, and anyone who was around Jerry enough knew that he had to have the touch of at least one woman before a tip-off to help him calm his nerves. Similar to Magic Johnson, for someone who refused to drink and smoke, women were the only outlet that West could seemingly find, his favorites at the time being airline stewardesses, as even professional athletes from different sports would often try their best to be around West, knowing that wherever he was, the women were sure to follow. However, while women may have helped West calm his nerves and subdue his madness, what West fully never grasped the ability to do was lower his expectations for others. As since West demanded a certain level of perfection from himself, he demanded an equal level of perfection from others. And that trait of West would carry on throughout the entirety of his playing days and into his coaching days, where you would have his first encounter with a player who would, over the course of his career with the Lakers, would come to know the full depths of the madness that is Jerry West. Jerry could never understand why his players couldn't go at it with the same ardor and passion that he did, Jack Ramsey. Jerry's just going to have to understand that there are only so many Jerry Wests around. That might be a problem that he'll have. Butch Van Bredekhoff. Our guards could never seem to get the job done to his satisfaction. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Jerry West, as great as he may have been as a player, never should have coached a day in his life. Due to his inability to communicate exactly what it was that he wanted from others, combined with his short temper due to his uptight nature, the locker room for the Lakers was often filled with nothing but obscenities being shouted at the players for the mistakes that they had made. Former player for the Lakers Ron Carter once told a story of where during his first game with the team as a rookie, West was so livid in the halftime locker room that he punched a chalkboard and broke his pinky. The reason? He didn't think they had gotten Kareem the ball enough and were down by a point. Being down by a single point at halftime during the first game of the season was all it took for West to snap. West, though, meant no harm with his outburst, and his players knew all too well the type of person he was, resulting in most of his players holding no hard feelings towards West. The only player that West truly didn't get along with during his coaching days was All-Star guard Norm Nixon. Now, just before Magic, there was Norm, who was one of, if not the fastest player in the league. Even during the times after Magic Johnson was drafted, though Magic was considered by all to be the best point guard in the league, Nixon wasn't too far behind. He could play. The problem was, he knew he could play. See, while Jerry West could get mad at anyone and everyone for the lack of affection, he hated very few people and very few things. Matter of fact, the only thing West hated when it came to basketball was losing. People who didn't hate losing as much as he did, people who didn't want to win as much as he did, and not the least of which, players who put themselves before the success of the team. Jerry West hated selfish players, and Norm's seemingly inherent selfishness, combined with Jerry's expectations being higher for Norm due to the position he played, resulted in a relationship that would only worsen with time, especially once Magic Johnson was added to the mix. Speaking of Magic Johnson, though, there would be no Showtime without Magic. The dazzling point guard was a wake-up call not just to the Lakers, but for the NBA as a whole. And seeing as to how there would be no Showtime in LA without Magic, it's only fair to give credit to the person who was credited with the decision of drafting Magic Johnson to the Lakers in the first place. Jack Kent Cook. In part 1 of this series, we talked about the owner of the Lakers during the Showtime era, Jerry Buss, and the penchant for young women that he had. Now in part 2, we have to discuss the previous owner, Jack Kent Cook, whose treatment of people, women especially, was foul enough that even the coldest of hearts shiver when hearing of his sadistic ways. He was the number one asshole who ever lived. He was totally, absolutely, unbelievably wrapped up in himself and had no respect for anyone but himself. Rod Hudley. If Jack Kent Cook were to rise up from his grave today, the event would be seen as the reincarnation of evil. See, Jack Kent Cook didn't just purposefully go out of his way to belittle people, he went out of his way to belittle them while making them confirm his belittlement. Claire Rothman, the then president of booking for the Los Angeles Lakers, would come to know this side of Cook all too well, as he would regularly call her into his office, berate her in front of at least one other high-powered executive of some kind, make her say that she would never do what it was that she was yelling at her for again, have her do a twirl, comment on her looks for the day, and then send her off. And it wasn't just Rothman that he was like with this, as Cook thought little of women in general. To him, they were mere objects, things to be looked at and then disregarded at best. His treatment of men whom he saw as beneath him, which was most, wasn't very good either. Whether it be promising a person, like legendary broadcaster Chick Hearn, a little something extra in his check as a Christmas bonus, only to include a wallet-sized picture of himself as that bonus, or telling a staff member at the forum to take off his jacket so he could use it to wrap up his dog, it was made clear that Cook truly did not regard the lives and well-being of others. The worst victim of his wicked ways, however, was his wife, Jeannie Cook, who after more than a decade of putting up with him in a quarrel that resulted in Cook suffering a broken arm, finally escaped from his clutches, only after she attempted to take her own life 4 times. Jack Kent Cook was a monster. The biggest monster in LA, though, was still without a doubt, cocaine. There was a lot of coke going on. Everyone did coke in those days. Late 70s, early 80s, it was everywhere. Everyone tried it. Anyone who says they didn't is a liar. The name Spencer Haywood is probably a name that most modern NBA fans have heard little of. However, his story is one that almost changed the entire course of Showtime for the worse. Like most players in the 80s, Spencer Haywood used cocaine. As his teammate Michael Cooper, who also used the drug, put it, "There's a difference between using cocaine and being used by cocaine. Spencer Haywood was being used by cocaine. I like pot because it was organic, but coke wasn't organic at all. It was manufactured, and instead of making me mellow and relaxed, it did the opposite. I would use coke and see bugs, spiders, the most demonic things that ever existed." Spencer Haywood. 2 pints of Bacardi rum, a good session with a crack pipe, and finished it off by popping a few quadrules, aka methoqualone, a sedative that Haywood would use to, quote, bring him down from his high. That was his ritual. The drinks to relax him, the dope to hype him up, and the qualudes to bring him back down. See, Haywood was often seen as one of the main guys to go to in the league for a party featuring cocaine. One incident involving such a party took place during a 14 preseason tournament that the Lakers were hosting, when a group of 12 players from different teams all gathered at Hayward's house for a crack session. Except, instead of having a good time, and the players leaving afterward, the crack pipe exploded, resulting in a handful of the league's top players having shards of glass shot into their eyes and arms. Haywood said that the incident shook the players so much that they had to wait a whole 10 minutes before resuming their session. And as you can probably guess, Haywood's addiction to the substance took a massive toll on his level of play and his relationship with the Lakers, especially his relationship with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, who hated Spencer Haywood. Even though Kareem openly admits to having used drugs such as cocaine and heroin during his college days, he saw what the drugs were doing to Haywood and how they were affecting the team as a whole. The worst incident coming during the playoffs, as despite the fact that Haywood and the Lakers were scheduled to have an 8 o'clock practice in the morning, Haywood found himself up at 3 o'clock in the morning smoking crack. Realizing that he needed to come down from his high before practice started, he began, of course, popping quaaludes. And by the time practice did start, Haywood was still so messed up that he fell asleep at practice as soon as he arrived. Realizing what was going on, the head coach of the Lakers, Paul Westhead, instructed Haywood to head home. His time with the Lakers had come to an end. Infuriated by being let go by the Lakers, Haywood then decided he would take his frustrations out on his head coach, as he phoned up a buddy who dabbled in organized crime in Detroit. Haywood was completely determined to take the life of his former head coach. They were going to do the job for free, for the sake of friendship and the prestige of having done a favor for old Spencer. Spencer Haywood. The plan was foolproof, Spencer thought. His buddies would sneak into Westhead's driveway, cut the brakes on his car, so the next time he was driving down the long, winding road he lived on, bang! His life would end in a tragic car crash, no one the wiser that it was set up by Spencer Haywood. Everything in place. His friends had already flown in from Detroit, and their resolve to commit the crime had not wavered. Paul Westhead was going to die. But get this, mere minutes before the operation was set into place, Haywood received a call from his mother, who told him that she had a terrible dream that he was going to kill someone, and said that if she ever had any suspicions he was involved in such a thing, that she would personally turn him into the police herself. Upon hearing this, Haywood called the operation off, sparing the life of the man who would coach Magic Johnson and the Showtime Lakers to their first ever NBA championship. That was actually going to wrap up part 2 of the shadow side of the Showtime Los Angeles Lakers. Now, this team is so big. I mean, they span over a decade. There's no way that I could get every bit of information and tell every story in just 2 videos. So if you guys want to see a part 3 in the future, make sure that you first like this video to let me know that you want to see that, as well as subscribe to the channel so you don't miss out on that video, plus many, 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 many more videos that are to come. Thank you so much for watching, though. You guys already know that you are the real MVPs, but with that being said, until next time, keep getting the buckets, Team SDC, and I'm out of here.